Erica Show. 안녕하세요, Erica Show 오신 것을 환영합니다. I'm your host, Erica from CryptoSoul, and I talk to the top builders and leaders in the blockchain space. And today, in episode 36, we have Santiago joining us today. I've been dying to talk to Santiago. Great to have you. Hello.
Hey Erica, it's great to be here. And been a big fan and listener of your podcast, and it's finally good to be here. Thank
Oh,
you for
I'm
having
so
me.
humbled. Oh my gosh. I've been, I think we've talked quite a bit on Clubhouse, and I've listened to you talk for quite some time. So I'm very excited to have you with us. And before we go in, there are many people who are curious about you, but could you give us a short intro about yourself and what you're currently working on, just briefly?
Yeah, so a little bit about me. I've been investing in crypto since 2012. Sort of by night, I was first at JP Morgan doing investment banking and private equity. That's when I first discovered Bitcoin and was fascinated by it. And I can touch on why. And then over the years, was doing more traditional venture investing in Palo Alto, so in Silicon Valley. And I was investing in open source software at a time where a lot of people didn't really believe that open source was powerful or could be monetized, could be really like, I think Linux is a great example of something that it's a great product, but it couldn't be monetized as well. And when I discovered Ethereum, to me, it was a huge eye opener. I didn't really know what it was going to be used for, but I said, this solves a lot of the issues of open source software development and continuity, where developers have equity and like through tokens, and it's expressed in a very clear way. And so, at some point, you just sort of, I gave up on trying to convince my fund at the time, that was more like traditional Silicon Valley venture fund, to invest in crypto. I sent my memo to invest in Ethereum and to a bunch of other funds, and everyone's just sort of like, no, like laughed me out of the room. And I said, well, okay, like I might as well just do this on my own. And most recently, I was at Parify Capital. I guess we were the first DeFi-focused fund coming out of the bear market. The fund's been around for 3 years. And the thesis that we had then and still do, I guess, is that most of the value in crypto will accrue in financial functions, or at least in the immediate kind of medium term. And so yeah, I've had the good fortune of working with many founders, and that's what I enjoy the most, really kind of going deep in particular projects. Like I was doing it with Synthetix when it was Haven back in the day. Did it with Aave last year and been working super closely with Stani. And so I like that the most of this space. I think it has, to me, why I love crypto so much is I think it's attracting the smartest people in the room. And you always want to be in a room where you feel, it's so cliche, but where you feel like you're like the dumbest person. And I've always consistently felt like crypto is that place where it's pretty daunting. There are way smarter people than I am in this space. And to me, that's what keeps me here, really.
Oh, that's a great intro, and I feel 100% the same. I feel intimidated always, 24/7, but I'm learning day by day, which is a great incentive for me to be in this space. And that's exactly what you just said. So thanks so much for that. And it's kind of, well, I guess, like, I think I've been in finance as well before crypto, and I think a lot of the finance people feel like an urge to enter crypto in some way because of the limitations of the current financial system. Have you felt something like during that time? It was pretty early. 2012 was like pretty early. Was there like a moment where you're like, aha, like I have to jump into, in your current career, that career of your time?
Obviously, I think a lot of things are obvious in hindsight. And I think that's a problem that I have with a lot of people in this space where they say, oh, yeah, like we knew that Ethereum was going to be a big thing, or we knew that Bitcoin was going to be a big thing. I'll be very upfront with you. For a long time, I didn't really know it was going to work. I just said, it's worth paying attention to the space. And what drew me initially to Bitcoin was the remittance use case. So I'm from Mexico. I for a long time has been bothering me that moving money cross border is super difficult and it's expensive too. And so for me, it's like this nagging idea that when you look at a problem, you walk around in the world and you travel and I think invariably you stumble upon your day and you say, God, there ought to be a better way to do this. There's friction everywhere, and in finance, there's a lot of friction. And to me, Bitcoin at the time, I had an idea that I was talking to my dad, actually. We were like, let's create some ATM network in Mexico where people can send money to the ATM. You get a text message in your phone and you can retrieve money. And I was noodling with that idea while I was at JP Morgan. I said, well, let's create this network. And, you know, Western Union charges you 8 cents, you know, 10 cents on every dollar that you send. And it's trillions of dollars at stake. And I said, okay, well, and in that process, I discovered Bitcoin. I said, Dad, like, scratch this idea. It's actually bad. There's this thing called Bitcoin. Let's try it out. So I went and bought a bunch of Bitcoin and then sent it to 10 people. And I said, well, 7 out of 10 can actually go through this flow of convert, you know, I buy Bitcoin, I send it to Mexico, and people can convert it to local currency. I said, at minimum, you're disrupting what is the second largest source of income for Mexicans, which is receiving money from relatives that live overseas, particularly in the US, sending money. And I think, to me, that's, I think, a killer use case, a better rail to send money internationally. And so that was what drew me to Bitcoin. And then what drew me to Ethereum when it was getting off the ground was, you know, this idea that you could express more logic into what Bitcoin allowed you to do, which is a very narrow use case. And but it was a very ambitious goal. I think when I was listening to Vitalik, I had the good fortune of kind of meeting him at a conference. He was, you know, building the world's supercomputer when he was 19 years old. And, you know, you get the feeling that he's super smart and he operates at a different frequency.
Yep.
But it was a gamble. But I think, again, the metrics that I've kept, you know, for me, that was like a hedge against Bitcoin, because at the time, nothing was going on in the Bitcoin camp, or the miners were very gridlocked, nothing was going on. And so for me, it was, okay, look, I'm willing to make a bet on Ethereum because I think the general, like, more expressivity at the smart contract layer is interesting to reach a consensus, right? Mm-hmm. For other applications beyond storing this thing called Bitcoin, which served as reasonable, had at the time a decent, I guess, store of value, or that was a bet. And for me, where I, you know, made a lot of mistakes over the years, investing in all kinds of stuff that I can talk about, like the biggest mistakes that I've done. But to be succinct, like in that process, I think where DeFi started to get really interesting is when you went into the bear market after 2018 and you saw the value of the collateral of ETH decline like 80%, and Maker, DAI, which is backed by ETH at the time, is pure ETH, maintained its peg. And I said, wow, like you actually, this is pretty interesting. This is an anti-fragile, could be an anti-fragile system or close to an anti-fragile system, which is very resistant. And if you were able to withstand that shock, and if you have a stable unit of account called DAI, okay, then you can do other stuff, like you can lend and borrow against that. You can issue. And so that was what I think Maker really, really made DeFi in a way that it opened up all these different functions. Because if you didn't have a stable, if you don't have stable coins, it's very, very hard to do a lot of the other stuff. And so when Maker really kind of was battle tested over the years through the last bear market, to me, that's where it became quite interesting. It says, all right, let's go and build all the other money Legos and invest in the obvious of the world, the compounds, Uniswap. And I think it's been sort of like a panacea of like different money Legos that have been built, right?
Kind of prove that it can actually build on top of each other. And I think the stability of the DAI, we really proved that. And so shout out to DAI, the Maker people, for getting that movement going. But thanks for sharing that. And you mentioned about Parify, and what was your, you know, you mentioned about helping out some like project, big projects like Aave. And what was your experience like there in terms of like, what do you mean by like building or helping, were you on top, like were you really like helping side by side in terms of like other things, like not only investing, but like I'm sure you did other things, but can you show us what you actually did at the firm?
So my investment philosophy, just from first principles, is look, I only invest in things that I use, and most of the time when it's a early stage bet, is I want to know and want to find alignment in one or two or three areas that I can help a team, a founder. And a lot of times it's not being prescriptive with advice, it's just listening to them and looking at what, you know, at the time for Aave, for instance, it was ETHLAND, it was pivoting. And I think I just found them. I was lucky to find them at the right juncture. This was DEF CON in Osaka. I thought, hey, there probably should be two money markets. Compound was live, and you know, for me, it was seeing Stani and the good founder that he is. Like he's just like, he has that killer mindset to be like, to win in DeFi. It's a very competitive space. And he had retained a lot of talent and they continue to build through the bear market. But I think they had suboptimal token design. A lot of the tokens were kind of in exchanges, in idle hands. Most people had forgotten that they had ETHLAND, right? I mean, it was like, whatever, right? At the time it was called ETHLAND, not Aave.
Right.
But I think it was in that process, I sort of drafted a proposal and said, hey, I think we should redesign the token and let's figure out a way to work together. And in the process, you know, help design Abenomics, which is what we see now, like the staking module and the transition to V3. And so obviously it was an iterative process. In no way, you know, am I claiming that I did everything, but I think it was a big undertaking, like talking to, you know, the Aave team and Stani in particular, you know, on a very, very recurring basis, like this, like at least once a week, we're just on the phone for hours talking about things and how to design the token and go to the community and like re-engage the token base and like the share like token holder base. And, and so, yeah, you know, I continue to be quite involved in there. So that was just an example of, you know, I think, you know, Aave was a big, big project for me and still is. And so like, you know, that was just one example, I guess.
Yeah, it's your baby. Well, Stani was on the show and he was talking about this whole history and it just rings a bell like, okay, well, there must have been some supporters and you were one of the major supporters. So it really does make sense how they made that successful transition to their new branding and everything. It was a big change for Aave. But yeah, thanks for, I mean, I think that-
Yeah, I mean, God, very... like, just for context, like people forget how quickly and non-linear these systems can grow. Mm-hmm. Aave was at zero TVL January of last year.
Yep, yep.
It is surpassed 20 billion now. Some of the things that, you know, we've done is help in the migration from V2 to V3 and incentivize that through the liquidity mining program.
Right.
Creating pilots for liquidity mining. Look, what's crazy is Aave grew without incentives. I mean, they didn't have a liquidity mining program. It just was, it allowed for different assets that, for instance, Compound wasn't doing. Like, for instance, like, you know, onboarding things like Wi-Fi as collateral and other, and, you know, it's just a matter of risk, right? It's not so much that I think Compound was focused on other things and that's okay. Obviously, Robert and the team are very, extremely competent. It's a huge success story, right? But that's not to say that Aave can't win, right? And so Aave was this more focused on flash loans, which is a great, like, I think a fascinating primitive in the space. And the other one was just, you know, onboarding different types of collateral and just being more mindful of the different risk parameters that you can embed. You know, onboarding X Sushi, for instance, was a big, something that I think was great because you then, you know, win over a community, right? Like Sushi. Now obviously there's a liquidity mining program. And so iterating on that and figuring out what is the actual best design here that incentivizes good behavior, migration from V2 to V3, higher utilization, stablecoin and ETH and WBTC volume. Like, I think that's like in the money market. And so like, it's a very iterative process, which is really fun because you're working with these teams on an ongoing basis.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the most fascinating aspects about the DeFi space is not only composability, but also like, I think flexibility. Because I think like the way that they really switch to more efficient solutions is really fascinating. I think people, it's just hard to follow basically how everything just happens in magic period of time. So yeah, thanks for going to that journey. And you recently left Parify, and I think a lot of people wonder like what you're currently up to. But,
in this journey, like I always want to like be doing, I think, what is most impactful that I think, given my skill set, that I can help the space most. And so, I'm quite excited to go back to my roots, which is for a long time I was just angel investing, and help, but helping projects again. This idea of helping a few projects. Very closely. And so I'm excited for this new chapter. I think the space is at a very interesting intersection and juncture. You're seeing this combination and intersection of NFTs, the metaverse, DeFi, which I think has a lot of connectivity and there will be a lot of value created. These are onboarding funnels for millions of users. What's going on with Axie and Flow and NFTs in general is fascinating, I think, because it just opens up the aperture of this industry in a very interesting way at the time where L2s are launching and other layer ones are launching like Solana and Terra or like have been out in the wild and are getting interesting traction. And so, you know, I can't kind of give a lot of details. I don't want to juggle or like dance around this idea of what I'm going to do next, but for now I continue to invest, angel invest and work very closely with teams. You know, what I tell founders that I was, you know, for me, the biggest privilege of investing, whether you're doing it a fund or as an angel, is collaborating with founders that have thought about a particular problem their entire life or for a long time. You just join them in that journey and try to help them in some capacity, certainly not get in the way. And so I love that. And so, you know, maybe I'll build something. Maybe I'll incubate. I have a few ideas, but I'm excited. You know, I tell founders, like, I'm not going anywhere. Like, I love this space. And so, you know, but again, this, and I've been pretty vocal about it. This intersection of NFTs, DeFi, the metaverse is fascinating. Like, I was looking at Axie and looking at the NFT flows and what's going on in certain communities. And I mean, it's really transforming, I think, many, many aspects, even fundraising. Like, I mean, what's happened with Bored Ape, Yacht Club, in the community that they've been, at the end of the day, all of these networks have built value, whether it's Bitcoin or Ethereum or Solana or, you know, any other project out there. I think value is a social construct here of these blockchains. At the end of the day, blockchains are coordination mechanisms. Coordination requires, it's a very social game, right? And so if you build a good community, then like that's the value. That's the reason for block. Like at the end, like what gives Bitcoin value? Well, it's turtles all the way down. It's like there's people that believe that you want to mine a Bitcoin and expend energy to get this thing called Bitcoin that has value and it's censorship resistant, yada, yada, yada. But it's social. It, at the end of the day, it is a social construct, like everything in this world. And I think NFTs have a lot of emotional cachet to them. And they could be good stores of value. I think, you know, a punk could be a better store of value than Bitcoin. Probably, maybe, I don't know, but it's interesting. And so I'm paying a lot of attention in this space.
yeah, thanks. That's a fair answer. And I think I saw your recent tweet about this very topic where you talked about social constructs. And I think the importance of if people who ignore this importance of, you know, social, I guess, constructs are going to miss out, basically. And it's a huge, I think communities also, I mean, as a community builder myself, I think it's super important. And it's not very tangible, per se, but I think they will maybe rule the world. I mean, I don't know. It'll be very fascinating to see what's going to happen in the, you know, near future. Yeah. But it's definitely worth the investment. You talked on a various range of topics that I want to touch upon. But okay, so let's start with you mentioned numerous times about the intersection between DeFi and NFTs, right? And it is definitely one of the most passionate topics, even in Korea. I think people are just fascinating about the metaverse and how, you know, DeFi can be meshed into that construct. But can you elaborate more on your, you know, I guess your insight or take on that aspect and what it can, you know, what potential it has, basically? Are there any examples, current examples that you find fascinating? Can you elaborate more on that?
Yeah, I think I'm probably going to regurgitate a lot of stuff that your audience knows, but like, you know, Axie is treading the ground to what is play to earn, what is known as play to earn, this idea that, you know, you're playing a game, you're earning a token that has value. And it could be, look, at the end of the day, this play to earn, there's some criticisms to play to earn, like, oh, you know, it's not sustainable. You gotta, at the end of the day, you know, especially in COVID, like play to earn has created employment for so many people in different places.
Right.
Which is meaningful. Like people are earning in the Philippines and Vietnam and Mexico and Venezuela income that is comparable or more than what they could be making being Uber drivers or Airbnb or like just, you know, minimum wage. Now the criticism to play to earn is, wait a minute, games are supposed to be fun. And the minute you introduce this like layer of making money, then it tampers with the pristineness, the purity of a game, and it becomes a chore and it's no longer fun. I said, fair, like I understand that, but I think it misses the point, which is, you know, at the end of the day, like, you know, games are very immersive and, you know, do certain scholars, for instance, of Yale Guild feel like it's like a chore and do they enjoy playing Axie all the time? I don't know, maybe. But I think that does, like, that detracts a little bit sort of from the main point, which is, you know, games historically have been really hard. If you look at the economics of games, so like it's like 1% of 1% of users account for like 98% of revenue, like Candy Crush. And then the half-life of users, which is this idea of like the retention of users, is terrible, right? You onboard all these users, everyone's fickle, like they play, like the top games in the App Store change so quickly, right? First it was Angry Birds, and then it's Candy Crush, and then it's and then it's the next and next and next. But certain games, look at Fortnite, look at you know, World of Warcraft, Call of Duty, like certain games are very, I think, have a legacy and continuity to them. And I think in many ways, look, have we seen the best games in crypto? Probably not. I'm excited about a few that are like launching. I think Axie is pretty fascinating. It's difficult, I think, for some to understand, but nonetheless, I mean, it's got incredible traction. I think it's gonna, latest I checked, I mean, they were the revenue that is being generated in this game is eclipsing or coming close to what Fortnite, which is probably the one of the most valuable games in Web2 land. It's like no joke. And so it's pretty wild that, you know, if you're playing Fortnite or World of Warcraft, you're creating all this value for skins, like you don't own the skins per se, and there's a lot of like bad experiences, which interestingly a lot of people in crypto come to crypto because they've had bad experiences like playing World of Warcraft or whatever, and then they got paid in Bitcoin or what have you. And so I think it's a pretty fascinating concept, like this idea. I think like something, you know, I invested in Yield Guild, and I think I was talking to Gabby and I said we both sort of saw eye to eye, which is there is a possibility here where you totally transform labor structures in a way that like you're giving in the same way that Uber and Airbnb, you know, created employment for so many people, right? You think about what Uber did. It's a pretty novel idea. You have the most underutilized, one of the more underutilized assets, which is your car, which sits idly 80, 90% of the time. And all of a sudden you empower people to make money off of that, right? But the economics are pretty terrible for a driver now. Same with Airbnb. You know, you have a spare room, your kids go to college, yada yada. You know, you can be a host, you can be a hotel. Now here's the thing. Both of those are asset light, but they're not asset free. But play to earn is like this idea of a metaverse. Anyone with a smartphone, anyone with a computer can log in and start creating money and making money playing a game. They decide how much they want to play. They decide if it's fun or not. I'm not gonna be a judge of that. But I think the premise of allowing people to play and earn and then port over perhaps an identity of a character in one game to the other, which we haven't seen that, right? That's probably 1 or 2 years out when you have all this game, is fascinating, I think.
Awesome. Absolutely. Thanks. That was my next question, but you touched upon it very smoothly. And I mean, this is a very, I didn't plan this, but Gabby's our next guest on the show. So
Wow.
this is going to
I
be
love
very,
Gabby.
he's wonderful.
He's a true visionary, yeah.
He is.
Here's the thing. He could probably run for president of the Philippines and win because he's probably
I
employed so many people, and he's like the most. He will probably. Here's. I'm willing to bet Gabby will probably become the most popular person in the Philippines if he's not already. You know what I mean?
Shout out to Gabby. Yes, absolutely.
That was the
He
goal, yeah.
has saved so many lives. And I think, especially during COVID, this has really accelerated this movement. And it has given a lot of hope for, I mean, I also live in Southeast Asia. So I see that desperate, I guess, the loss of opportunities, especially in employment. So this is a great way to have a gateway for that. Yeah, this is amazing. actually, in Korea, just to elaborate a little bit more on you mentioned about like how you lose your items on like the Web2 games, right? When the platform just kind of disappears out of nowhere, kind of, you know, lose everything that you invested in. And Koreans really can relate to this because there is this, it's not a game, but it's a platform called SiWorld, and people have lost, I've lost so many acorns, which is like, you know, you just put like fiat money, you buy the acorns, and I just lost so much money on that, but because they failed as a platform. So when I tell this example, Koreans are just like, you know, they understand it so quickly because of this very experience. And I just wanted to point that out. Yeah, it's everywhere. And yeah, it's amazing. So yeah, thanks for that. And so recently there's been a comeback on, you know, the NFT boom. I think it will definitely come and go. Of course, DeFi is it's not going anywhere, but there has recently been a more like a, I guess, on the penguins, right? And penguins and the punks, of course. But what's your take on the avatar, you know, NFTs? I mean, I personally love them, but there are some arguments about using them as a collateral, right? And you know, what do you think of that argument? Is it too early, or is it gonna actually work?
No, I think there's is it's probably the next frontier. You know, Uniswap in the early days was like felt like this. So it's like, oh, you know, like why would you trade in a decentralized manner? And there's this thing guy in permanent loss, and it's never gonna work. And people in traditional finance have said you would never trade in Uniswap. You can use Binance, you can use a centralized exchange, an order book model. But it required a little bit, and look, it took time to build. It took a couple of years. People don't kind of appreciate that, but you know, it took years, right? And it was a lot of work, and but it was not obvious. Now, of course, everyone like trades and you know, things like Uniswap, and it's the most widely used protocol out there in DeFi.
Mm-hmm.
I sort of see that as the next frontier, which is the more interesting thing for me of NFTs is it starts with art, but it expands much more beyond that to general illiquid assets, right? What is an NFT is a non-fungible token. So it expresses a very specific item thing. And it could be an insurance contract. It could be a parcel of land in the real world, in the metaverse. It could be, you know, you kind of saw it with WineSure, which was like taking Nexus cover, and then it created a secondary market. And that in and of itself became an Oracle price feed for Nexus, which is materially grossly underpriced, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what that is massive, right? If you can bring if you can express illiquid assets in an NFT form, then you can, a lot of these have metadata. And so you can create reasonable price floors. So like what, for instance, now we have an index of what is a punk a floor, right? Which is like 143,000 right now, right? And that, to your point, yeah, has increased dramatically. Like the fact that we're having this conversation about that you're saying the resurgence of NFTs and your reference punks is because there is a price feed that you can reasonably say, okay, NFTX is this ETF of sorts that like tracks punk floors. And why? Because punks or floor punks have certain metadata attached to them, that they have certain characteristics that make them a floor punk. And then there's zombies, there's apes, there's different tiers, right? But all of that is represented in data, right? It's very clear what is everyone knows and can agree upon and reach consensus again on what is a base punk and what is a not base punk. What is a zombie, an ape, right? Now, obviously it's visual, right? People see the image and they recognize if it's an ape or not, right? And it's like, but at the end of the day, it's the data that actually renders that image. But the metadata is the value layer here that most people don't appreciate when they just look at art, right? Because it's very visual. But what I'm trying to say is like the real value is in that metadata layer, which allows you to then piece together, say, like, I don't know, say that you're in Korea and you have District 5 in Seoul near a certain hotel in downtown. So okay, you have different parcels of land represented as NFTs. This is building one, this is apartment in this building. Mm-hmm. But then you can say, okay, buildings in this vicinity in Seoul, you can bundle them all together and then create a reasonable floor of apartment complexes of one bedrooms in Seoul.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's like, so that creates interest, like that creates better price discovery on these apartments, right? Because otherwise, what happens in illiquid assets like real estate, which has decent velocity, is it's very transactional, right? You require transaction, but sometimes, you know, there are not a lot of transactions, right? Picassos don't get there's not sales of Picassos every other day. There's not sales of apartments every other day, right? And so, at the end of the day, like, you know, that's what's really exciting for me, which is you express this stuff in data that allows you to piece together and create packages of illiquid assets and bring better price discovery. And when you bring better price discovery, what does that do? Well, it creates, you know, allows you to do different instruments, meaning you can borrow and lend against them, right? You can have better price discovery. You can fractionalize that if you so wanted to. And so I think like it will unlock a lot of value and it will create, I think, massive, massive economies as a result of that, and efficiency gains in real estate, in factoring, which is like lending for like invoices and all this stuff, like Centrifuge is trying to do and a couple other projects. And like, that's where we're going. It starts with art. The general logic can be expressed for so many other things, but it starts with good data and expressed on chain. And so that's why I'm super excited about this space. I mean, I'm not an art connoisseur by any stretch of the imagination. And I love one of my punks, which is the one that was on the Fortune cover. I love that one. I don't think I will never sell it because it's just, I see myself in it. Which I wanted to say is, you know, back to this idea for art and for something like a punk, for instance, just more like the social, just changing gears a little bit. Like we talk about like how this could be financialized and all the utility and the values being created by bringing liquidity to liquid assets or price discovery is like this idea that like, as we spend more time in the digital world, in the metaverse, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then is it too crazy to say your digital wardrobe is empty today? for everyone in the world. Well, what is, you know, you're going to want to dress up your identity online because it is more scalable. It is more visible. Mm-hmm. And now people are like, wait, why hasn't this happened? Right? The internet's been around for some, it's like digital scarcity. That's it. Mm-hmm. That's it. Yep. You can now have, if you like, I don't know, Gucci or whatever, like, well, Gucci's going to issue 20 or one of a particular sneaker. Well, that's going to have a lot of value. And yeah. Not only that, but like music, for instance, I was talking to Justin Lau yesterday. Mm. He's been at the forefront, right? Of like disintermediating the music industry and creating, okay, well, hey, it's pretty cool that you say, everyone talks about music. I was an early supporter of this artist. I went to this so-and-so concert. There's kind of no way to prove that, like, right? Other than like, oh, I was sharing this on Facebook or whatever. But now you can say, hey, look, I own a piece of this record label, which was issued the day one that like Avicii was playing, and I was there and I bought it, and here's, and so you, what I'm trying to say with all this is people will want to dress up their digital identity. Mm-hmm. And I think most people haven't really woken up to that construct, but younger generations very, very much so, I think, are gravitating. And I think you see this in China and places like in Asia, like people don't want to consume necessarily. They don't care about certain physical luxury items. They want experiences. I think that's been sort of a generational, like, a consumer preference shift in younger generations. Like people don't necessarily care about owning a yacht or owning all this real estate. They want experiences. And I think that's like NFTs kind of do that, because you buy a punk, you're not just buying a punk, you're buying access to a community that is so thriving. You buy a Bored Ape or you buy whatever, right? Autoglyphs, or do you join a DAO that has NFTs, and it becomes a very special community that I think is quite powerful.
It defines you in your, metaverse identity. And actually, when I was just about to interview you, I saw your profile. I was like, wow, I like this. I like your profile photo. And I just felt like, so, I don't know, like I felt the urge to change mine. So I got, because I purchased a pixel art NFT from a Korean artist. And I thought that was pretty Korean, I guess, pretty authentic. So I changed that. And I think, I don't know, it just feels like, you know, us together, like in that, in our own new profile photos. Yeah, it just really shows new connection. I don't know, like how to explain that. But
the more like, at a more like philosophical level, and this might but I was just in another discussion with, you know, podcast, was like, the construct of identity, I think, is changing for the better, right? Because historically, humans in their primitive brain have just said, okay, well, you know, I affiliate because the color of my skin and certain physical properties and traits, you know, you gravitate towards the familiar, which is, hey, this so-and-so person is my same height, comes from my same country, speaks the same language. Mm-hmm. But I think like it's super fascinating, this anonymous culture in crypto, which is, and generally like these communities have formed none other than purely on the value of your contributions. Okay, these are people that think like me. And then from that starting point, you say, okay, this is kind of interesting, right? And so to me, that's super powerful, because obviously, unfortunately, we live in a world where still there's a lot of discrimination. Still, there is a lot of, hey, you know, I this is my clan. But I think the idea behind creating an identity that is anonymous is kind of really powerful, in the sense of like, it doesn't give people, when people don't see an actual physical image of you, it doesn't allow them to jump to a conclusion, and it forces them to defer judgments. Like, I don't know what this person stands for, because I don't know if they're white, black, Hispanic, Latino. I don't know. I don't care. I actually, there's no way for me to do that. And so it forces your brain to just say, okay, well, what does this person stand for? What does he think? Right. And to me, that's always been a nagging problem, which is like, why do people care about all this stuff so much? Like, why don't you just ask me, what book have I read lately? And what am I thinking as of late? As opposed to, what's my last name? Or where do I come from? Or where did I study? Candidly, no one gives a fuck. You know what I mean? Like, I hired Nick, who I discovered in Twitter, and I never saw him until like he signed the offer. I'm like, okay, you want to go on like webcam just to like see if you're like a real person, not a robot? And you know what I mean? But like, I came to that conclusion because I was seeing his contributions. And to me, that's powerful, because consciously or subconsciously, I probably would have made certain judgments about Nick had I learned other things about his physical properties, traits, education background,
Absolutely.
I didn't even ask him for a resume.
Yeah.
I mean, after the fact, like I learned that he was a freshman and he was dropping out, which to me was super bullish. Just the fact that someone's willing to do that. But that's the power of NFTs, I think. Like my
Absolutely.
Digital identity, and this is why I have my avatar, because I don't want people to know, like, you know what I mean? I guess they can find out if they Google me or whatever, but like, I want to give people a fair shot at understanding who I am and what I represent by virtue of looking at my digital identity and say, okay, this person has a punk. Okay, that means something. And he's also really active in these communities. Okay, that also means something. And then you dress up different pieces in your digital identity. And I think that gets us to a better state.
Yeah,
cool stuff. Absolutely. Like in a world where like people are just, again, the physical traits cannot be ever ignored, right? Because at the end of the day, we live in the physical world and we're social beings. But I think these online communities, the Olympics are going on now. I don't know. I don't affiliate with a particular country. What's to say that like Bored Apes or punks can't have an Olympic team in 5, 10 years? Esports, like, you know, do younger generations like think of themselves as more Mexican or Korean, or do they actually affiliate themselves more with their clan of World of Warcraft or like Nazi? I don't know. I'm just thinking about that. I don't think we're there yet, but we could.
Yeah, definitely we could. And I am already kind of, you know, I think us as a NFT at the enthusiast, I think we do have this clan where we really kind of engage with one another really well. And yeah, I mean, it can definitely be defined as that kind of a certain clan, well, certain communities and who likes this crypto punk or yeah, I want one of those, by the way, but I'm I'm waiting for it. But yeah, great insights. I'm fascinated by it. So there was this, you know, kind of change in subjects, but in DeFi, right? In yesterday, was it? There was, you know, this huge hacking incident, and you know, I'm sure you have some insights about it or your thoughts about it. I would love to hear what you thought about it. Of course, you know, there's been some, but I think this was the largest by far. I would say.
I think it was. Yeah, I think it was, at the time, I think it was like the largest. It's been the largest hack. Full stop,
yeah,
right?
Full stop. Yeah, full stop. So it's been, you know, all over the Korean news as well. Can you share with us what you what you thought of this incident? Should be laughing,
yeah.
But yeah, what do you think?
Well, it's obviously a shame that these things continue to happen.
Yeah.
It is sort of the collateral damage of moving fast and things breaking. I've been very vocal for quite a bit of time that we need better insurance models and more standards. But how do you kind of marry that with, there's a lot of innovation in space and a lot of, you know, why can you create standards at a point where the industry is moving so fast and expanding in multiple dimensions and creating more surface area, you know, of different, like pushing the envelope in smart contract and code. And so like, I sympathize with that. I actually had never heard of this project before.
Me
which is
either.
Crazy. And I'm like, wow. Like, I mean, it felt like a year ago, it was easy for me to keep tabs on every single DeFi protocol and what was happening in the space and the community. But I guess, you know, when you, it's a testament of like how quickly the space is moving and it creating like different clusters and galaxies around and multi-chain world and what have you. But look, it's a shame. It is, I'd heard that they kind of identified or were able to track down the hacker, given his IP address, and he was sending stuff to Binance, and so Binance had some. So, you know, I think like hopefully that you know, funds get recovered and returned and restored. But you know, I think the last thing I'll say is it is sort of like a moral imperative of founders and investors in space to say, hey, wait a minute, like, you know, we can say all day long, look, at the end of the day, it's like the Wild West where users can come and go and it's their responsibility to do diligence. But, you know, I think it's not enough. I think teams and founders and investors need to kind of do some self-policing. And, you know, I guess like I understand and sympathize with regulators when they look at this and it's like, well, this is not fun, right? Because people are getting hurt. Whose fault is it? You know, are we ready for a truly permissionless world, an immutable world where, you know, like things happen? And, you know, I'll just be quick on the insurance piece. Like I was talking to the team about this yesterday. Like when you buy a car, you know, you buy a house, that's when you think about risk, right? Hey, I just bought this. I want to protect it, right? If you don't buy it at that time, it's done. You're really, consumer behavior is such that people forget about this stuff until a hurricane hits, too little, too late, unfortunately, or you get flooded.
Right.
And the car is right, is you by regulation, you buy it. So what needs to happen, right? You embed, imagine a flow where you get insurance by default.
Mm-hmm.
That's what needs to happen here. When you buy, when you interact, you just say, hey, you may not even give the user the option. It's opt-out versus opt-in. It's like, by default, you're going to get insured. Mm-hmm. And you're going to pay for it, right? You're earning 15, 20% APY. Like, what's 2% to insure your assets? But you don't even give the consumer the preference. You just tell them, if you don't want it, you know, let's you know, opt out. But yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for your insight on that. It's been a crazy ride for the past, you know, day or so. So I just wanted to get your insight on that. But talking about the, you know, politics, U.S. politics has been quite, you know, crazy these days. And I think you've been I think you tweeted quite a bit on that. But can you kind of summarize basically like what the current status is and like what's, you know, because I think from outsider standpoint, it just kind of seems like, okay, well, it seemed to be going well. And then now it's kind of in this deadlock, but can you kind of share with us like what's going on and, you know, what your thoughts are on this issue? Because it's quite controversial.
On which one, sorry?
The US politics, you know, the politics on, you know, crypto.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think it's a necessary dialogue, I think, that needs to happen. I think as an industry matures, I sort of think that naturally, you know, regulators take an interest in, and look, for a long time, we've been wanting regulatory clarity. And I think it's necessary for the space to continue to grow. And as an industry grows up, I think there ought to be, you know, sensible regulation. It was interesting to observe. I'm not an expert on it, but the experts that I was following were very encouraged by some of the proposals and amendments. And then it felt like a setback at the last minute. But I don't, you know, this is where like, I don't fully kind of understand like how this legislation passes and how these amendments work. But it's really interesting. I think we're living in a very interesting time where, you know, this space will probably, in order for it to continue to grow, really like really fulfill its vision, will be, you know, to, it will require, you know, because a lot of, I think, institutions, a lot of professional folks, or just a lot of users generally are still on the sidelines thinking, hey, I just need better visibility in this space. And I think with good, and my hope is that with good, sensible regulation,
mm-hmm.
We can really, this space can really scale order of magnitude, right?
Yeah.
And DeFi, I think in my mind, continues to be an experiment by a few that are willing to venture into this world and be a beta tester. Mm-hmm. As things get built, this idea of like building an airplane as it's kind of, you know, rising. But I think, yeah, like I'm optimistic. I think regulators understand that there's a lot of innovation here. There's a mm-hmm. lot of value that can be created for good. And, you know, I think countries want to be competitive. And so I think like ultimately the smartest people are going to want to leave a country because it's not easy to build and right. innovate in that particular country. Then, you know, I think they're going to go elsewhere. And my hope is that, you know, people understand that and work towards common ground that gives a lot of clarity to a space that's needed it for so long.
Absolutely. SEC Commissioner Hester Peirce was here a few episodes ago, and she was emphasizing how she really wants enterprise to come to the U.S. and build. Hope that really happens in the, you know, in the future. But yeah, it's been quite a, I mean, it's still ongoing, but I think, you know, a lot of countries like Korea, South Korea, for example, are like heavily watching what's happening in the U.S. So we'll see. Interesting. So, I mean, we have, this is September. So we have about, yeah, September, August. So we have a half a year left almost. And is there anything that you're, you know, working on that, you know, any milestones, personal, it can be personal, career-wise, that you want to share with us? And, you know, also in line with that, what is your, I guess, vision in crypto, I guess? And you know, as I think you mentioned earlier in your earlier questions, but like, what do you want to achieve ultimately as your, you know, as yourself? Yeah.
Yeah, I think this year is shaping up to be quite interesting. It's crazy, but we're only halfway through, and I think for me it was quite exciting to see the London upgrade in Ethereum and move to to EIP 1559 be implemented. I'm excited to see layer two solutions get things like Arbitrum really kind of go live. I think Arbitrum is launching end of the month. It's been in beta, but there's been a lot of projects that have been building on top of Arbitrum, for instance. And I think that I think opens up really interesting ideas of things that may have been tried before that haven't been working because it's been perhaps a little bit expensive to some of these use cases. But in a layer two, it's sort of you go back to the drawing board and say, okay, what are the things that haven't worked but may work? And in some capacity, you're seeing that in Solana too, or another like Terra and other interesting ecosystems. Polkadot is set to launch too, and so I think like my view has always been it's going to be a multi-chain, multi-world universe, and for different use cases. And so then how those interact together will be pretty interesting over the next coming years. So I'm excited to see that. Hopefully this regulatory stuff gets cleared up in a better way for things to kind of really move forward. So I'm really excited. I mean, I think continue to see very encouraging signs of like a lot of developers joining, a lot of companies taking an interest in crypto. And so to me, the biggest barometer of this space and where it's headed is human capital. And I continue to see smarter, more capable, competent developers and people from all walks of life take an interest in crypto because it's really interesting technology, but it hasn't, but it's addressing problems that haven't been solved. And so I think that combination is pretty powerful. So I'm excited about that.
Yeah, thanks for that. Last question. So a lot of Asian, like I think company people will be watching this show, and I think a lot of I think Koreans near me are kind of intimidated to kind of enter the DeFi or NFT space because of the language barrier, and there's like this Twitter culture that they don't really can't really associate with yet. So do you have any advice for them, people who want to enter the space from Asia, maybe who are kind of don't know where to start? Where would you kind of What kind of advice would you give them? And that'd be great to for the viewers.
Yeah, the best advice I would give them is I think this space has a lot of opportunities for people from all kinds of backgrounds and skill sets. I would recommend join some Discord communities, poke around, talk to people in different. I think you'll find that most people are really welcoming in this space for the most part, and so just join different communities and ask questions, right? Ask. There's no basic question. Everyone started a very basic kind of level of understanding of what these things are, and I think like take the time to just learn about stuff without a particular agenda or this like FOMO or just whatever. Like just be patient. I think like for me it took time to kind of create frameworks of how I think about the space, and it wasn't all very obvious. I made a lot of mistakes over the years, a ton. More like and I think ultimately like I keep tabs of where I made them and why I made them and try to like not make them again, but I understand like what was I thinking at the time that led me to do this and that. And I think for the most part it's been because there's always I guess there's always this idea that you can learn more. I think I learn by doing, and for me doing is interacting with people that are much smarter than I am and are building and are thinking about these problems, and then being a part of that journey and understanding that process, and then taking that and saying, okay, this is where I think value is going to be created in these pockets and these people. And so but that's just my journey. I think everyone has a different journey, and what's fascinating is that you could be interested in NFTs, you could be interested in DeFi, you could be interested in gaming, a million other things, right? You could be a political scientist, an anthropologist, a psychologist. There is so much in crypto. Crypto is perhaps the most multifaceted industry out there. And we all certainly have a lot of very technical people, very tech competent cryptographers, some economists, some game theorists, like, but hey, where are the political scientists? Where are the psychologists? Where are the behavioral theorists, right? And so I think that's a pretty it's a sort of an open invitation to everyone that from all walks of life really that can just become experts. Like, I mean, I think a prime example of that, let's say, I think Hayden taught himself to code Solidity and then build Uniswap. on the fly. And so like that is like hallmark example of someone that is such an impressive journey. And so I look at that and I say, well, if he was able to do it, like that, there's hope for a lot of people, right? And so not, obviously he's wicked smart, he's super competent, right? But I think in the early days, right, I mean, he taught himself to code. Like that's fascinating, right? That someone can, you know, at the end of the day, someone can do that and create so much value on a global scale really quickly is very encouraging. So, you know, I think people look at that and it's hard not to be excited about crypto when you see that type of success story.
Absolutely. Learn by doing, and also follow Santiago's Twitter. That's also a good start. you summarized very well, and you know, I think I learned so much from your insights. So I always thank you for that. But yeah, thanks for so much for being on the show, and you know, I look forward to catching up offline in the near future.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, thanks so much, and see you.
It's great. It's great to be here. Yeah, no, thanks so much, and please continue to do what you do. You have great audience and shows, and great speakers, and you know, hopefully people enjoyed this one. But otherwise, I'll be tuning in to certainly the one with Gabby. I'm excited to listen to that one. But we need more education, and you do such a good job at it. So thank you for what you do.
Thank you so much. Okay, talk to you soon. Bye bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Ciao.